On debate, Senator Wallen.
Thank you, Speaker. Colleagues, it is truly unbelievable that we are actually debating the need to protect free speech in Canada. What was supposed to be an update of the Broadcasting Act and new rules for big tech has become something else entirely. And as the minister himself said, if you think Bill C-10 is controversial, wait until you see the next one, meaning Bill C-36. And we now can quite clearly see the government's true intent with the introduction of this companion bill. It might be a good time to remind ourselves that members of the current Liberal cabinet quite openly embrace the idea of empowering the federal government to control social media. Infrastructure Minister Catherine McKenna said that if social media companies, quote, can't regulate them yourselves, governments will. And let me also note that bills come into force and effect through regulations. And in a draft order from Minister Guilbeault in April, he stated that the rules must be consistent with the government's vision and represent the government's broad intentions. He also said that these regulations should target the damaging effects of harmful content that ridicule politicians or diminish public institutions. Seriously, criticizing politicians should not be allowed, should be censored. These bills are an affront to what many of us believe to be democratic and Canadian values. Bill 36 is dangerous, Bill 10 is badly flawed, and both undermine free speech and impose censorship. Let me focus on Bill C-10 and the many concerns raised by experts, academics, producers, and internet users about what's in the bill, what was taken out, and what's still missing. First, remember the process by which C-10 made it to the Senate. The tactics used in the other place to get this bill here before rising for the summer are both an insult to our parliamentary democracy and it's embarrassing for many. Big tech lobbyists wanted Section 4.1 of the bill out. That is a core clause, clearly protecting individual users on social media from being considered online broadcasters and therefore subject to regulation and possible censorship. But the government summarily removed the protection clause from their own bill against the advice of even their own drafters. When repeatedly asked to explain, the Heritage Minister said simply it wasn't necessary. Well, it is. If you are not explicitly exempted, then you are implicitly included. Of course, this was an alarm bell for experts and the public that the bill could give the CRTC the power to regulate free speech online. Even as these concerns were raised at committee and as the public opinion soured, the government then invoked closure to shut down committee work on the bill, something that hasn't been done for 20 years. MPs, even liberals, overruled their own committee chair in what looked like a mini coup, and introduced sweeping and secret amendments. The Speaker of the House quite rightly declared all these secret amendments to be null and void, and you would think, colleagues, that this would be a message to the government to rethink their approach, redraft the bill. No law should accidentally risk silencing free speech. And if a bill needs dozens of amendments just to appease an interest group or garner electoral support, then it's time to go back to the drawing board. We saw this same thing happen with Bill 69. Instead, the Liberals reinduced all of their secret amendments and forced a marathon session just to get their way. This bill will not finally be dealt with until the fall, given the timetable, so there was no need for this shocking authoritarian display. But here we are. So let's look at what Bill C-10 will do. It says that the Canadian broadcasting system should meet the needs of the Canadian public with a focus on ethnic and language and many other minority groups. It directs web giants to fund, invest in, and produce Canadian content and media. And it grants the CRTC more powers of oversight and regulation. And I refer you back to the minister's words. All of this must be in line with the government's vision of the world. The requirement for online services to promote Canadian content through new discoverability rules is a problem. because Section 4.1 that explicitly protected user-generated content, your tweets or Facebook posts or uploads to YouTube, is gone. The government that argues that Sections 2.1 and 2.2, which exempt some social media users from being considered online broadcasters, is enough. Again, I disagree. You could drive a truck through these loopholes. So let's be clear. If this bill becomes law, it will change what your internet content looks like, and no doubt how you choose to interact with it. Senator Dawson tried the old prop up and then knock down the straw man trick, assuring us that government does not want to censor or regulate cat videos or photos of your lunch. But that's not the issue. This is about who gets to decide what a Canadian online broadcast undertaking is, and it's about what Canadian online content means, and about what type of content will and won't be pushed onto your screens, and by definition, what content will be pushed so far down that it disappears. That is not just regulation, it's censorship. Of course, there was no explicit language that says free speech will be banned. They don't have to say it. By requiring online platforms to promote the government's vision and CanCon through discoverability requirements, as directed in Section 26R, they are determining which programs are Canadian and what Canadian content is not. We are giving tech platforms and the CRTC the authority to decide what is and isn't Canadian. Some will pass the test and some will not. And so who might pass the test? Well, according to the minister, perhaps those posting content critical of the government of the day would be deemed un-Canadian. What about content that reveals tough or controversial truths about the country's history? What happens to Canadians who regularly upload critical political content? Again, in the minister's own words, the government intends to introduce several pieces of legislation that are designed, and I quote, to support democracy and social cohesion in Canada by building citizen resilience against online disinformation and building partnerships to support a healthy information ecosystem, close quote. Translation, if you disagree with what qualifies as disinformation, then be very careful about what you post. You can see why so many are saying this is an infringement on free speech. And if Canada tries to impose these broadcasting requirements, we would be the only democratic country to do so. It will meet great resistance, and it will serve to undermine our ability to claim the adjective democratic. So again, should we be granting the power to decide what is and isn't Canadian to the CRTC or some new commission of appointees that the minister has referenced, or to big tech companies themselves? Our online activity is already easy prey to secretive, discriminatory, and sometimes politically biased algorithms of tech companies like Google, Facebook, Twitter, and Amazon. And they are not afraid to use their power to silence critics. We have seen this play out stateside. We have heard the threats here. Indeed, Bill C-10 and now Bill C-36 have been cheered on by proponents specifically for their powers to silence online voices, with which they disagree. I am reminded of the words of Noam Chomsky. If we don't believe in free expression for people or ideas we despise, then we do not believe in it at all. So why doesn't this bill make sure that these algorithms are more transparent? Senator Simons pointed out last week, you cannot accurately regulate digital forms with analog tools. I agree. The Broadcasting Act needs to be, to use the buzzword, reimagined to reflect the reality of the internet. Domestically produced content shouldn't need to be unduly promoted or mandated on streaming platforms. If it's good, people will seek it out and watch it, and they do. That's what the stats tell us. Wasn't that the whole point of the internet in the first place? To be an open platform for all content, to give us choices. Any changes to the Broadcasting Act should protect these freedoms for consumers, in line, of course, with the criminal code. Colleagues, are we still so insecure about our cultural identity that we need to forfeit our right to free expression and diversity of opinion in exchange for some government-defined, politically acceptable Canadian content? Let's celebrate Canadian talent and creativity and Canadian success in the international marketplace and on the global stage. Shouldn't we be modernizing the Broadcast Act to empower Canadian content creators, whether or not they produce a predetermined kind of Canadian content? Imagine if we asked Canadian actors to star only in films shot on Canadian soil, or movies featuring only Mounties or maple syrup or mountains. Shouldn't we ask Canadians if they even want the internet to be regulated in this way? I think it's clear from the response to Bill C-10 what their answer is: a resounding no, thank you. Most young Canadians get their news and entertainment online. It's even a career choice for some. Most people want to be free to choose what they watch and free to say what they want. And yes, let's make big tech algorithms more transparent, not just more Canadian, whatever that might mean. And let's not stifle free speech in the process. There is a clear solution to the issue of Canadian cultural producers not getting their fair share of revenue from big tech. Just tax them for it and pass it on. So let me reiterate, if this bill becomes law, it will change what the internet content looks like, and no doubt what you post. This is about who gets to decide and define what Canadian online content means and what will and won't be pushed onto your screens, because if some content goes up, other content goes down. And that is not regulation, it is censorship. Our colleague and CSG leader Scott Tanis used an old Western saying to describe what the Senate's response to the government's disrespectful attitude toward this place is: your bad timing is not my emergency. We do have time. Let's do this right. Consult, seek consensus, and make changes that support creative Canadians. I ask the government to go back to the drawing board and present us with well-considered legislation. Then let us properly study a better Bill C-10 and other related bills. It is our job to employ sober second thought. However, the track record of the government accepting Senate amendments is poor. We receive far too many bills that do not just need amendment, they actually need a rethink and a rewrite before they ever come to us. The bills must respect the charter, not leave it to the courts to do the heavy lifting that government should do before they even present legislation. It's lazy. But more importantly, it usurps our rights and responsibilities as parliamentarians. The late Liberal MP Reg Elcock was perhaps the canary in the coal mine on this, warning that politicians are always wary of the internet's impact. Information technology changes the balance of power, he said. It changes the balance of power in society, and it changes the power balance in Ottawa. And Ottawa is all about power. Then he added, what you can't change, you desperately try to control. And that is what these bills are all about, control. Please, colleagues, reconsider. This is a reckless approach. And think, just think of the consequences when it is someone else's turn in power, when those you don't agree with are the ones making the judgment calls. Thank you, colleagues.